Now salvation by day, and my cry by night before thee. Let my prayer come before thee, bow down thy ear to my supplication. Bless the Lord, my soul, and all that is with me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, my soul, forgive for all that he hath done for thee. Most gracious and not all thy iniquities, forgiveth all thy infirmities. Redeemeth thy life from corruption, and crown thee with mercy and compassion. Fulfillest thy desire with good things. Thy youth shall be renewed like eagles. The Lord performed the deeds of mercy, and executed judgment for all them that are alone. Yet being his ways known to Moses and the sons of Israel, the things that he hath put, compassion and merciful is the Lord, long suffering, and plenteous of mercy, not to the end of the beginning, but to the end of eternity will be wrought. Not according to our iniquities have been dealt with us, neither according to our sins have you rewarded us. For according to the height of heaven and the earth, the Lord hath made his mercy prevail over them that fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far have you removed our iniquities from us. Like as a father hath compassion upon his son, so hath the Lord had compassion upon them that fear him. For he knoweth whereof we are made, he hath remembered that we are dust. As for man, his days are in the grass, as a flower in the field, so he flourishes. But when the wind is passed over it, then it shall be gone, no longer will it know the place thereof. The mercy of the Lord is from eternity, even from eternity upon them that fear him. And his righteousness is upon some of his sons, upon them that keep his testament and rivers and rivers to do them. The Lord of heaven prepared his throne, as he who rules over all. Bless the Lord, all ye his angels, mighty strength and performance word, and hear the voice of his words. Bless the Lord, all ye his hosts, the ministers that do his will. Bless the Lord, all ye his works, in every place of his dominion. Bless the Lord, all my soul, in every place of his dominion. Bless the Lord, all my soul. O Lord, hear my prayer, give the earth my supplication, thy truth. Hearken unto me in thy righteousness, and raise not the judgment of thy servant. For in thy sight shall the living man be justified. For the enemy hath persecuted my soul, and humbled my life down to the earth. Yet sat me down in darkness as though it had been long dead. And my spirit within me has become despondent, as in me my heart is troubled. I remember the days of old, I meditated upon all thy works, thy power of the creation of thy gates. Stretch forth my hands to thee, my soul thirsted after thee like the water of the land. Make me hear thee, O Lord, the spirit of faith and life. Turn not thy face away from me, lest I become like unto them and go down to the pit. Cause me to hear thy mercy, O Lord, for in thee have I put my hope. Cause me to know, O Lord, the way wherein I should walk, for unto thee have I lifted up my soul. Rescue me from my enemies, O Lord, unto thee have I fled for refuge. Teach me to do thy will, for thou art my God. Thy good spirit shall lead me in the land of brightness, for in my name's sake, O Lord, shall thou go to peace, and thy righteousness shall thou bring my soul out of affliction, and thy mercy shall thou administer all my enemies, and thou shalt cut off all that afflict my soul, for I am thy servant. O Lord, give ear to my supplication, and enter not into judgment with thy servant. O Lord, give ear to my supplication, and enter not into judgment with thy servant. Thy good spirit shall lead me in the land of brightness. Glory to the Father, to the Son, to the Holy Spirit. Both now and ever, to ages of ages. Amen. Alleluia, 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 glory to thee, O God. Alleluia, 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 glory to thee, O God. Alleluia, 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 glory to thee, O God. O our God and our hope, glory to thee.
In peace let us pray to the Lord. From above and for the salvation of our souls, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the good estate of the holy churches of God, and for the union of all men, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for those with faith, reverence, and the fear of God enter therein. Let us pray to the
Lord.
For our Father, Metropolitan Joseph, for the venerable priesthood, the diaconate in Christ, for all the clergy and the people, let us pray to the
Lord.
For Metropolitan Paul and Archbishop John, and for their quick release from captivity and safe return, let us pray to the Lord. President of the United States, for all civil authorities and for armed forces everywhere, especially for Peter, Joshua, Ronnie, Adam, Andrew, Benjamin, Thaddeus, Honor, and Skylar, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this city and for every city and land, and for the faithful who dwell therein, for healthful seasons, for abundance of the fruits of the earth, and for peaceful times, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For travelers by sea, by land, and by air, for the sick and the suffering, for captives and for their salvation, for those in persecution for the faith, for our deliverance from all tribulation, wrath, danger, necessity, let us pray to the Lord. Help us, save us, have mercy on us, and keep us, O God, by thy grace.
Lord, have mercy.
Calling to remembrance our all holy, immaculate, most blessed and glorious Lady Theotokos, and ever Virgin Mary, with all the saints, let us commend ourselves and each other and all our life unto Christ our God.
Unto thee are due all glory, honor, and worship, to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever, and unto ages of ages.
Okay, thanks to the Lord and call upon his name.
mercy on us and keep us, O God, by thy grace.
Lord, have mercy.
Calling to remembrance our all-holy, immaculate, most blessed and glorious Lady Theotokos and ever-Virgin Mary, with all the saints, let us commend ourselves and each other and our whole life unto Christ our God.
Cease your wailing and crying and shrieking, peace,
have mercy on us and keep us, O God, by thy grace.
Have mercy.
Calling to remembrance our all holy Immaculate, most blessed, glorious Lady Theotokos, and ever Virgin Mary, with all the saints, let us commend ourselves and each other and our whole life unto Christ our God. Stand upright, let us hear the Holy Gospel.
Peace be to all. The reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Mark.
Glory to thee, O Lord, glory to thee.
Let us be attentive.
When the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of James and Salome bought spices so that they might go and anoint Jesus. And very early in the morning, on the first day of the week, they came to the tomb at the rising of the sun. And they were saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the door of the tomb?" And looking up, they saw that the stone was rolled back, was very large. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, dressed in a long white robe, and they were amazed. And he said to them, "Do not be amazed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He is risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him, as he told you." And they went out quickly and fled from the tomb, for dread.
marveling and astonishment had come upon them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid.
Glory to thee, O Lord, glory to thee.
And if we behold the resurrection of Christ, let us bow down before the Holy Lord Jesus, the only Son of the Lord, by our cross to be a power of Christ, and thy holy resurrection be praised and glorified. For thou art our God, and we be none than another beside thee. We call upon thy name, O come, O ye faithful, let us the tour of Christ's holy resurrection. For lo, to the cross is joy come into all the world. Ever blessed is the Lord, let us sing his resurrection. For in them he endured the cross for us, he has destroyed death by death.
Mercy on you, God, according to thy great mercy, and praise the moment of thy compassion, blot out my transgression, wash me clean from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know what iniquity and my sins are before me. The only thing of my sins is not received before thee. Thou mightest be justified when I was failed in our judge. Behold, I was conceived in iniquity and sins of my mother Mary. All that is not true. Thou shalt wash me nice and make white as snow. Thou shalt make me your joy and gladness. The bones that be humble, they shall rejoice. Turn thy face away from my sins, and thou art humble and iniquity. Create me a clean heart, God, and renew my spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of thy salvation, and with thy comforting spirit establish me. I shall teach transgressors thy ways, and how they shall turn back to thee. Let me be called guiltiness, O God, the God of my salvation. My tongue shall rejoice in thy righteousness. The Lord, thou shalt open my lips, and my mouth shall declare thy praise. For if thou hast desired sacrifice, I have given it. All burnt offerings thou shalt not refuse. The sacrifice of God is a broken spirit. A heart that is broken, and humble God will not despise. Good, O Lord, thy good pleasure is thine, and the walls of Jerusalem be built up. Then shall I exchange the sacrifice of righteousness, the donation of all burnt offerings. And shall we offer rulers upon thine altar.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, to the intercessions of the apostles, O Lord, who are merciful, watch out all the multitude of our transgressions.
Christians, and send down upon us thy rich mercies. Through the intercessions of our all Immaculate Lady Theotokos and ever Virgin Mary, by the might of the precious and life-giving cross, by the protection of the honorable bodiless powers of heaven, at the supplication of the honorable glorious prophet, forerunner, and Baptist John, of the holy, glorious, all laudable apostles, Peter and Paul, and of all the holy apostles, of our fathers among the saints, great hierarchs and ecumenical teachers, Basil the Great, Gregory the Theologian, and John Chrysostom, Athanasius, Cyril and John the Merciful, patriarchs of Alexandria, Nicholas of Myra, Spiridon of Trimethos, and Nectarios of Pentapolis, the wonder workers, of our fathers among the saints, Tikhon, patriarch of Moscow, and Raphael, Bishop of Brooklyn, of the holy, glorious, great martyrs, George the Trophy Bearer, Demetrios the Mercer, Theodore the Soldier, Theodore the General, and Enos the wonder worker, of the higher martyrs, Ignatius the God-bearer of Antioch, Charlampos and Eleutherios, of the holy, glorious, great women martyrs, Thecla, Barbara, Anastasia, Catherine, Kyriaki, Fotini, Marina, Paraskeva, and Irene, of the holy, glorious, right, victorious martyrs, of our venerable and God-bearing fathers who shone in the ascetic life, of Saint Barnabas, the patron and protector of this holy community, of the holy and righteous ancestors of God, Joachim and Anna, of the higher martyr Amphimos of Nicomedia, venerable Kikostistos, fellow ascetic with Euthymios the Great, martyr Sheraton, new martyr Polydoros of Cyprus, Phoebe, the diaconess of Kinkare, Vigis Vasilisa of Nicomedia, and Ionikios, the first patriarch of Serbia, whose memories we celebrate today. And of all thy saints we beseech thee, O most merciful Lord, hearken unto the petitions of us sinners who make our supplications unto thee, and have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy.
Our God, have mercy on us and save us.
Amen.
My Savior, whom you have called us, praise the Lord, and all of us who are chained to the shadows of your feet, as the one that has risen from the grave, let us all give praise and give thanks to the soft mercies and the praises of Christ, the King of our God, that is arise from the dead on the third day, taking us shadows again.
Righteous Basilisa, Nicomedia, and my own
the Theotokos, and the Mother of the Light, let us honor and magnify in song.
Thank you.
Great is thy mercy, and great is thy
Salvation of our souls, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the good estate of the holy churches of God, and for the union of all men, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for those who with faith, reverence, and the fear of God enter therein, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Our Father, Metropolitan Joseph, for the venerable priesthood, for the abbot in Christ, for all the clergy and the people, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Metropolitan Paul and Archbishop John, and for their quick release from captivity and safe return, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the President of the United States, for all civil authorities, and for armed forces everywhere, especially for Peter, Joshua, Ronnie, Adam, Benjamin, Andrew, Thaddeus, Skyler, and Connor, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this city and for every city and land, and for the faithful who dwell therein, for healthful seasons, for abundance of the fruits of the earth, and for peaceful times, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For travelers by sea, by land, and by air, for the sick and the suffering, for captives and for their salvation, for those that are persecution for the faith, for our deliverance from all tribulation, wrath, danger, and necessity, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help us, save us, have mercy upon us, and protect us, O God, by your grace.
Lord, have mercy.
Calling to remembrance our all holy, immaculate, most blessed and glorious Lady Theotokos, and ever Virgin Mary, with all the saints, let us commend ourselves and each other and all our life unto Christ our God.
To be of you all glory, honor, and worship, to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever and unto ages of ages.
Thine is the majesty, and thine is the kingdom, and the power and glory of
us, O God, by thy grace. All whose remembrance are all holy, the immaculate, most blessed, glorious Lady Theotokos, and ever Virgin Mary, with all the saints, let us commend ourselves and each other and our whole life unto Christ our God.
Thank you.
Let us pray to the Lord.
Holy art thou, Lord God, and up to thee we ascribe glory, to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever,
and unto ages of ages.
Amen. hear the Holy Gospel.
Peace be to all.
And to thy spirit.
The reading of the Holy Gospel is according to Saint Matthew.
Glory to thee, O Lord. Glory to thee, O Lord.
Verse 10.
The Lord spoke this parable. There was a householder who planted a vineyard and set a hedge around it and dug a wine press in it and built a tower and let it out to tenants and went into another country. When the season of fruit drew near, he sent his servants to the tenants to get his fruit. And the tenants took his servants and beat one, killed another, and stoned another. Again he sent other servants, more than the first, and they did the same to them. Afterward he sent his son to them, saying, "They'll respect my son." But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, "This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and have his inheritance." They took him and cast him out of the vineyard and killed him. When therefore the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants? They said to him, "He will put those wretches to a miserable death, let out the vineyard to other tenants, will give him the fruits in their seasons." Jesus said to them, "Have you never read in the scriptures, 'The very stone which the builders rejected has become the head of the corner'? This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes."
Glory to thee, O Lord. Glory to thee, O Lord.
Before we proceed with the homily, it's our happy duty to church cable.
Thank you.
13th Sunday after Pentecost, the church presents to us Christ's parable, the wicked tenants in the vineyard. Now historically, this story refers to the Old Testament kingdoms of Judah and Israel, of course, and how they misbehaved toward God over the course of their covenantal relationship with Him. The people were supposed to bring forth good fruit in their knowledge of God, but they did not. And when God sent His servants, the prophets, to warn them, to call them to repentance, to return them to the path which would produce fruit, these prophets were, as St. Theophylact of Ohrid once wrote in his commentary, abused in various ways by the husbandmen, that is, the false prophets and the false teachers of those times. One they beat as they did Micah when Zedek struck him on the jaw. Another they killed as they did to Zechariah, the father of St. John the Baptist, between the temple and the altar. Another they stoned as they did to Zechariah, the son of Jodeh, the high priest. So what Christ was telling the people was a very literal historical account of how they had slaughtered the prophets really right up to his day and turned aside the correction of God. But beyond the literal historical meaning of this parable, there's also, of course, a metaphorical application for all of us as well. Since we too live in a covenantal relationship with God, and sad to say, we also often find ourselves lacking in the kind of good fruit that is supposed to come forth from that kind of communion and relationship to God. We're called to grow in the fruits of the Holy Spirit, including foremost of all, love, which produces mercy, kind forbearance with others in their failings, generosity in giving, self-sacrifice and service, and patience, especially patience not only with one another, with God perhaps, but patience with ourselves to keep on doing what is right and not giving up. These are all fruits of the Spirit, fruits of our relationship. But sometimes in place of these good things, we often harbor judgment of other people. I mean, most of us judge anywhere from 3,000 to 5,000 times a day. We resent people, we have hurt feelings, we're so easily, you know, we're so oversensitive, we're easily offended. Selfish, of course, not to mention that we lack in just essential things like prayer and an overall abiding faith in God. Of course, it's not because we're worse than most of the people. This is really simply the human condition to which we are all born and which we typically also spend most of our lives cultivating, right? We don't spend most of our lives cultivating faith, love, and spiritual understanding, but selfishness and irritability and so forth. It's extremely hard to undo such bad habits, to produce good fruit in Christ, especially when we are hampered with, okay, there's more, sloth, spiritual sloth, and a certain indifference to the things of God, which again is a symptom of the human condition. We've got a lot working against us when you add that up. And yet, despite these handicaps, we have the Holy Spirit as well within us, which is a pledge of God's love for us, that He gives us His Spirit, that indwells us, the same Spirit that gives life to the world, and gives us power to change our lives for the better. So in that sense, you know, with the help of the Holy Spirit, we are like laborers in the vineyard, in today's parable. We're out digging about in the dirt of our souls, toiling, sweating, in the hope, of course, of producing fruit, that God will bless our efforts with rich and abundant fruit. It's often discouraging to think of all the hard work that we have to do. You know, all you have to do is think about, oh, it's time to say my morning prayers. And that big, heavy weight settles in on your chest once again. Well, it's also depressing how little we progress, it seems, beyond that so often. But I think it's also good for us to remember a couple of other things, so we're not just strictly depressed. The first, we need to remember, and this is verified in our parable, that God has already done the bulk of the work for us. You know, in the parable, the householder planted the vine. First of all, he had a house. He was a householder. He planted a vine about it. He built a hedge about the vineyard, which is effectively a protective fence, a wall to protect the vines and the workers. He dug a wine press to process the fruit. He built a tower to watch over and guard, perhaps supplying water from that tower. I don't know what kind of tower it was. But all the workers really had left to do was tend the vines and harvest the fruit, because the homeowner had done everything else. And that's our job today. God has built his church. God has filled it with everything that we need to produce fruit. We're not starting from scratch. Here's some grape seeds, good luck. But we have everything necessary for newness of life and salvation already laid out for us. So when we get down to it, the hardest part of the work that we have left to do is simply wanting to do it. Simply that desire. And that's where our problem lies so much of the time. So what happens when we don't want to do the work? What happens when we know we should pray more faithfully and really work at nurturing our communion with God? You know, maybe you wanted to sit down some evening and pray at a conference. Maybe you say, yeah, I really need to read more in the Gospels. And that's a great intention. But maybe it never happens. What happens when we know that we should be more faithful in keeping, in attendance, just a daily mindfulness of God, in focusing on repentance and truly bettering our way of life, as we say? But don't. We keep putting it off. What happens when we're more comfortable feeling guilty than doing the things that bring us joy in Christ, doing God's work, feeling like we're doing the thing we should do? Isn't that strange? I'm not really sure what happens, but I think you might call it a little crazy. I'm sure there's a more sensitive and, you know, better way to say that, but it is kind of crazy when you think about a people who are more willing to live with guilt and shame than to get up and do the work that will bring joy and bring them closer to God. You know, habitual tolerance of sin and sloth is not a sign of a healthy mind. It's a sign of a darkened mind. It's a sign of a little bit of insanity. And yet, you know, this is one more indication that we're fallen and broken people in need of healing. But I mention it because we need to realize this is not right. And the way that we think often is not right. And, you know, we often talk about in the last days, everyone will go crazy. Sort of, if they see a sane person, they'll say, you're crazy, you're not like us. You know, everything is upside down and backwards. And there's great darkness of intellect, darkness of thought. If you read through the scriptures, if you read through any of the sacred writings, you find often, over and over again, this theme of do not trust yourself. Do not lean on your own understanding. Have a spiritual father. Listen to the holy tradition. Be guided by it. Listen to the church. Do not trust yourself. And so we read this, and what do? We trust ourselves. And we believe ourselves. And we believe our perceptions of all things. And we don't understand that we're darkened. We don't understand. Like the people in this parable, God understands that we need help. I mean, people didn't understand that, but we're like those people. God sends us prophets. God sends us help to guide us back, to guide us out of the darkness, to guide us out of the insanity, really to guide us back to love, because love is what this is all about. God sends prophets. Sometimes they're teachers or preachers or father confessors, but not always. Sometimes the prophets that God sends are just ordinary people, or even situations or circumstances. Your flat tire could be a prophet sent to you by God, because in some way it challenges you. Have you ever had a person or a situation, I'm sure you have, come into your life that caused you to think, wow, this person or this thing was sent by God? Maybe you didn't realize it right away. Maybe it was somebody who encouraged your faith and you said, well, you know, thank God. Maybe it was somebody who proved that you didn't have any faith, who challenged your faith or made you angry or something like that. But only later did you realize, wow, that really was from God, so that I would, you know, be so sensitive, or that I'd be, you know, more forgiving. Whether it was good or whether it was bad, you realize that it was from God ultimately to help you be a better Christian, to love. And it's true, you know, people or circumstances, we all have things that we wish were different, better, normal, whatever. But when we finally realize that all these different things and all these different people and all these different challenges are from God, they're prophets sent to us to correct us, we begin to maybe live the way God wanted. What happened to the prophets that God sent in the Old Testament? They got killed. They were persecuted. They were hated. They were driven out. What happens a lot of times to our prophets? If there's any message in our gospel lesson for us, it is probably this. Don't kill the prophets. Somebody comes into your life, and some co-worker, whatever, your boss, and just seems to be a constant source of irritation. Maybe this is a prophet sent to you by God so that you can learn to pray, so that you can learn to love and forgive and be forbearing and be kind and return good for evil, the sort of thing. You know, whatever. Don't resent the situations God brings into your life. You're not getting what you want. You're not getting enough money. You're not getting the house that you want. You're whatever. It's not just a frustrating situation. It is God. There are no accidents. Everything that happens to you, even where you are right now today, every circumstance of your life is governed by the will of God. And we spend so much time fighting, complaining, being unwilling to accept, wanting it to be different, killing the prophets that he sends to us. Recognize, even in the bad, the goodness of God, the overwhelming love and care of God toward you. Listen to God. Rejoice that he loves you with unyielding faithfulness. God loves you so much that he's willing to make your life miserable, if that's what it takes. You know, there's always a certain measure of sorrow in the Christian life. You know, godly sorrow. This is what Jesus refers to. Blessed are they who mourn. He doesn't mean those who mourn because they didn't get the Cadillac they wanted, but they mourn because, despite all their best efforts, despite their faithfulness, despite their kindness and generosity, they're still sinful. They're still dark. And they mourn. And that's godly sorrow, because that keeps us in repentance and it keeps us doing the right thing. But there's also an ungodly sorrow when we don't get what we want, or we don't do what we need to do and we feel guilty over it. That's, you know, that's just guilt. And that means we need to do better. So listen to the prophets in your life and learn from them. And you will begin to see God present in your life in a way much greater than ever before, much clearer and much closer to the glory of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Help us, save us, have mercy on us, and keep us, O God, by thy grace is done.
All praise that Barnabas, by thy might, who may ascribe glory unto thee, to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever. Thank you.
remember his kingdom, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages.
Christians, especially for those suffering from Hurricane Harvey, for Maximus, Basil, Emily, John William, Carl, Tucker, Carly, Debbie, Joe, Green, Lynn, Kevin, and for Sybil, for those in our parish with child, Maggie, Michelle, Claire, Mary, Lori, Lauren, Taylor, Serena, Stephanie, Christina, Autumn, and for Kelsey. May the Lord our God remember them in his kingdom, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages.
Orthodox servants of God, especially for Korea, Mary Sue, for Nadine and Pete, the Lord God remember them in his kingdom, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages.
Transgressions, all things good and profitable for our souls, and for peace in the world, let us ask of the Lord. That we may complete the remaining time of our life in peace and repentance, for a christening to our life, painless, blameless, peaceful, and a good defense before the awesome judgment seat of Christ, let us ask. Calling to remembrance our all holy, immaculate, most blessed and glorious Lady Theotokos, and ever Virgin Mary, with all the saints, let us commend ourselves and each other and all our life unto Christ our God.
Through the compassions of thy only begotten Son, with whom thou art blessed, together with thine all holy, good, and mighty Spirit, now and ever and to ages.
Love one another that with one accord we may confess.
Praise thee, to give thanks in the name of worship in every place, of thy dominion, for thou art God, ineffable, inconceivable, invisible, incomprehensible, ever existing and eternally the same. Thou and thy only begotten Son, and thy Holy Spirit, thou it was who didst bring us from non-existence into being, and when we had fallen away, didst raise us up again, and didst not cease to do all things until thou hast brought us back to heaven, and hast endowed us with thy kingdom which is to come. For all these things we give thanks unto thee, and to thy only begotten Son and thy Holy Spirit, for all things of which we know and of which we know not, and for all the benefits bestowed upon us, both manifest and unseen. And we give thanks unto thee also for this ministry, which thou hast vouchsafed to receive in our hands, even though there stand beside me thousands of archangels and 10,000 of angels, the cherubim and the seraphim, six winds and the eyes, soaring aloft, borne on their pinions, singing the triumphal hymn, shouting, proclaiming, and saying, the boldness to the end, not unto judgment or unto condemnation. And again, we offer to thee this reasonable service for all those who in faith have gone before us to their rest. Patriarchs, prophets, apostles, preachers, evangelists, martyrs, confessors, ascetics, that every righteous spirit may be perfect in faith. Especially our own holy and active, most blessed and glorious, they may have been gracious and ever virgin Mary.
Thank you.
the Holy Spirit with these gifts he has spread forth unto all of us for good, according to the individual need of each. Voyage with those who sail by sea and air. Journey with those who travel by land. Heal the sick. Thou who art the physician of our souls and bodies. Through the grace and compassion and love toward men of thine only begotten Son, to whom thou art blessed, together with thy own holy, good, and life-giving Spirit, now and ever and unto ages of ages.
Down, O Lord Jesus Christ, our God, from thy holy dwelling place, and from the throne of the glory of thy kingdom, and come to sanctify us. O thou who sit on high with the Father, and art here invisibly present with us, and thou save by thy mighty hand to impart unto us by the manifold body of precious blood, and through us and through all thy people, throughout the verses of this sin.
Let us attend
holy things are for the holy.
body and blood of Jesus Christ is served in the Orthodox Church to those who are not just Orthodox, but those who are Orthodox and have prepared themselves to receive this precious body and this precious blood through prayer, through fasting, through readying themselves even the night before to set aside all earthly cares and to come and partake of the kingdom of God. If you happen to be visiting with us today and you're not Orthodox, I welcome you after the service as people come forward to venerate the cross, to partake of what we call the holy bread, the blessed bread in the church that is for everyone to partake of, visitor and Orthodox alike.
With the fear of God, with faith and love, draw near.
Thank you.
O God, save thy people and bless thine inheritance.
Come upon you through his grace and love towards mankind, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages. through the intercessions of his all immaculate and all blameless Holy Mother, by the might of the precious and life-giving cross, by the protection of the honorable bodiless powers of heaven, at the supplication of the honorable glorious prophet, forerunner and Baptist John, of the holy, glorious, and all honorable apostles, of our Father among the saints, John Chrysostom, Archbishop of Constantinople, whose divine liturgy we now celebrate, of the holy, glorious, and right victorious martyrs, of our venerable and God-bearing fathers, of St. Barnabas, patron and protector of this holy community, of the holy and righteous ancestors of God, Joachim and Anna, of the Hiram martyr and Theophilus of Nicomedia, the venerable Theopistos, fellow ascetic with Euthymius the Great, the martyr Cariton, the new martyr Polydorus of Cyprus, Phoebe, the deaconess of Chancheria, of the righteous Basilisa of Nicomedia, and the Juanikios, one patriarch of Serbia, whose memory we celebrate today, and of all the saints, have mercy upon our saviors, for as much as he is good to love us mankind. Through the prayers of our holy fathers, Lord Jesus Christ, our God, have mercy on us and save us.
Amen. Once again, I refer you to the bulletins for your announcements, which are in here somewhere. Couple of things. This week, service schedule is a little bit different. Wednesday Vespers here is canceled in favor of Thursday at 6:30 p.m. That's the liturgy of the Nativity of the Theotokos. So that is, of course, at 6:30 p.m. We've had a few folks